Hi, my name is Charles from RCBenchmark.com. About a year ago, my colleague and I were designing a small direct drive helicopter. There was a big problem. We had only about 4 minutes of flight time. To understand what was going on, we designed a thrust test rig that could measure torque and consequently efficiency. It took a lot of time, code, and electronics, but in the end, we more than doubled the flight time. To increase flight time, we had to understand what the measured information means. In this series of tutorial, I will help you understand how changing the motor parameters will affect the motor performances, such as efficiency, torque, and power. This information is useful for every design using a motor. After, I will discuss propeller theory and the selection of motor and propeller for a flying machine. I want to make this series different by explaining the theory and giving you an intuitive understanding of the equations while using very practical examples. The most important concept to understand is the coil permanent magnet model. You can see the coils and the magnets in this brushless motor. I will come back on the real brushless motor later, but for now, let's assume that the motor is a simple coil and magnet, and it outputs mechanical energy. First, a coil is made of a wire wound around a ferromagnetic material. The wire is isolated by a thin coating, which is actually electrical insulation. It is very fragile, so if you wind the motor yourself, you have to be careful not to scrape it off. On top of the assumption that our model is a coil and a magnet, I will assume just for a minute that the motor is not moving, or that the motor is stalled. This will help us understand the heat losses. When you apply a voltage potential between both ends of the wire, there is a current going through your wire. Since the resistance of your wire is constant, the voltage is proportional to the current. First, the sum of all voltages around a loop must always come back to zero. This is Kirchhoff's law, which we will revisit in a few slides. Based on that, we know that if our battery provides 10 volts, we must have 10 volts applied on the motor, which here is modeled as a resistor. Again, this is assuming that the motor does not move. I can measure the resistance in the coils of my motor. In this case, the resistance is 0.3116 ohm. Note that I'm measuring the resistance of one coil in this motor. The equivalent circuit resistance must be calculated based on the construction of the motor. We will explain this in our next video. Knowing the equivalent resistance of your motor, you can then use Ohm's law to calculate the current going through it. Assuming the equivalent resistance is 0.5 ohm and the battery voltage is 10 volt, we have 20 amps of current going through the motor. Power is defined as voltage multiplied by current. Using Ohm's law, we can rewrite the power formula to P equals to R times I squared. All the power that goes through a resistor is converted to pure heat. Using our previous example, applying 10 volt to an equivalent resistance of 0.5 ohm will create 200 watts of heat. Since it is a small motor, all this heat will make the motor very hot. This is why stalling a motor is not good for both the battery and the motor. Obviously, a motor is not just a resistor. The second important concept is electromagnetism. The current in the coil generates a force. The force is proportional to the current and the number of turns in the coil. A logical conclusion is that to get more torque out of your motor, you just need more turn in your coils. This is true, but there are two problems. The first one is resistance. The more turns you have, the longer your wire is, and the more resistance there is in your wire. If you increase the resistance, there is less current going through the coil, and you lose efficiency. That leads to a second problem. You may increase the motor size instead of using thinner wire, but then the motor is heavier. For example, we rewound this motor to add more turns, which forced us to use thinner wire. The problem was that we needed higher voltage to run at the same speed, and that the motor was overheating. Now, I will introduce an important diagram, the torque speed diagram. Right now, we have been looking at the motor stalled, and at maximum torque. If we reduce the voltage, we are also reducing the current in the motor, and the torque is lower. Let's update our model with a moving motor. The current in your coil generates a magnetic field, which will interact with your magnet. When the magnet moves in this magnetic field, the voltage in the coil changes. In a motor, this is the back electromotive force, or back EMF. Our model now looks like this. From Kirchhoff's law, we know that the current is constant throughout the circuit. This is the diagram when the motor is not moving. There's a voltage drop at the resistor. When the motor starts to move, there's a voltage drop due to the back EMF. Using Kirchhoff's law, we know that the sum of the voltage drop will equal the battery voltage. As the motor speeds up, the back EMF increases, and the voltage drop through the resistor is smaller. Since the voltage drop at the resistor is smaller at higher speed, the current in the circuit is smaller, and the torque is also smaller. Now, what happens when the back EMF equals the battery voltage? There is no voltage drop at the resistor, so no current and no torque. This is the no-load condition. It happens if you run your motor at full throttle with nothing on it. On the torque speed diagram, this condition happens here on the graph. If we are in between the no-load and stall condition, the point of operation is moving on a straight line. For a brushless motor, changing the electronic speed control input is similar to changing the voltage. When reducing the ESC input, the line of operation stays parallel to the original line. The no-load point and the stall torque point will move if we change the throttle. For an ideal ESC, changing the throttle will be equivalent to changing the battery voltage. Let's look at the model from an energy conservation point of view. The motor outputs energy in two ways: heat due to the resistance, and mechanical energy. Usually, your goal is to minimize what portion of the energy goes as wasted heat in the resistance, and maximize the mechanical work done by the back EMF. First, let's look at the mechanical power. This is the useful power, as it is what is transmitted to the wheel or to the propeller. The mechanical power generated by a motor is the torque multiplied by the rotation speed. This means that if the motor speed is zero, but there is a torque, there is no mechanical power generated. Equally, if the motor spins and it has no load, there's also no mechanical power generated. You can represent this on the graph on the right. White represents no power, darker red represents more mechanical power. There is no power generated when the speed is zero or when the torque is zero. From those equations, you can also note that the back EMF is proportional to the motor speed. The constant of proportionality is the motor constant, kV. If you want to measure experimentally the kV, click here. Now let's have a look at the heat losses. The heat losses are proportional to the square of the current going through the motor. Remember that the current is also proportional to the torque. For a given motor, if the torque increases, the current increases. The total electrical power used by the battery is easy to measure. It is the battery voltage times the current. Equally, the total energy used by the motor is the sum of the electrical losses and the mechanical output. The power distribution looks like this. On the left, you have the heat losses, proportional to the square of the torque only. On the center, you see the mechanical power. Finally, on the right, you see the sum of the heat losses and the mechanical power, which is the total power used. Using the torque RPM graph, we can make some observation that will be useful to optimize our motor selection. At any time, your motor is operating somewhere on these graphs. In practice, your operation point will travel depending on the condition of operation of your vehicle. Let's look at an example. The red point represents the point of operation. Here, we are operating at a low RPM, high torque point, which would be, for example, a car going uphill at a low speed. The torque is high, so there are more heat losses due to the current. In this case, we are not operating at the maximal mechanical power point. On the right, you see the total power required. Since there's a lot of heat losses relative to the power output, the efficiency is low. Let's look at another example. This could represent a car traveling at constant speed on a small road. The speed is high, but the torque required is low. Consequently, our electric motor has less current losses. We are also not operating at maximal power, but the mechanical power output could be similar to the previous example. In this situation, the motor is more efficient, as there is little heat losses compared to the mechanical power output. Let's draw lines to help finding the best operating points. First, on the left, you see the constant heat losses line. Those lines are horizontal, because the heat losses don't change with the motor speed. I only drew three lines, but there's an infinity of them. The lower you are, the better. On the center, you see the line of maximum power. If your motor's operation RPM and torque is not on this line, your motor is not working at its full potential. On the right, you see the line where maximum efficiency occurs. The further away you are from this line, the less efficiency you have. If your goal is to maximize flight time or endurance, you will want to make sure your motor's operating conditions are on this line. The maximum efficiency line is always lower than the maximum power. This means that your operating point will not be the same if your goal is to maximize power output, to win a race for instance, or if your goal is to fly longer. This concludes the first part of our series on motor theory. In our next video, we'll look at real brushless motors, at the electronic speed controller, and we'll explain how the timing of the motor affect motor performances. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to like and subscribe. Thanks and bye-bye.